Hello. There are quite some questions on synchronization, or at least about settings for a BMV, a smart shunt, or even a multi when it comes to the state of charge monitoring. I often see comments as, the state of charge is about 80%, but the voltage is down to 11. Why is this? Does the BMV need repairing or what? Well, often these funny readouts are a result of wrong settings, and then the readouts are simply useless. In this video, I will try to explain a few things on how a state of charge calculation works, and will try to give you some advice on settings to make the monitoring as accurate as possible. First of all, why is there a need for synchronization of a battery monitor anyway? Well, the problem starts with the fact that you can see in no way what the state of charge is by looking at it. The battery looks exactly the same when it's empty or when it's full. Unlike when you fill a bucket with water, you can see how much is inside. With a battery, that's simply impossible. You cannot place a sensor inside, as you can do with a normal tank, and you can also not see what the weight is to determine how much is inside. So what can you do to determine the state of charge of a battery? Well, you could measure the open clamp voltage, of course. This might be an indication of what the state of charge is. But this only works when the battery has not been charged or discharged for quite some time. And this voltage only gives a rough estimate and not much accuracy. What a better way is that you measure precisely what level of energy you take from it, and you can also measure how much energy you put back in. As you know what capacity of the battery has, at least the capacity you paid for, you should be able to calculate how much should be there still inside. The problem is, you need to start with the calculation from somewhere, from a certain known state of charge point. And besides this, another problem is that there will be deviations in measuring, so there will be a certain error in calculation which results in a more and more unreliable reading over time. Therefore, you need to synchronize the state of charge calculation with the actual battery state. So, in order to understand the options in setting up a battery monitor, I would like to explain a little bit on how the battery is working, as the settings for the state of charge calculations are based on these principles. There are of course many different kinds of batteries, but today I will cover only lead acid batteries and lithium batteries. You might say, well, I have a gel battery or an AGM. Well, these are also lead acid type batteries, just as calcium, lead carbon or other deep cycle batteries. So first on to the lead acid battery. When you want to know when the battery is fully charged, you can have a look at what a charger, which is connected to the battery, is actually doing. A typical charger starts a charge cycle after being switched on with its maximum current. This is the first phase of charging, and it's called the bulk phase or boost phase. So when having a 25 amp charger, in bulk it will do 25 amps. During this bulk phase, the voltage of the battery will rise from the voltage when the charging was started to the guessing voltage. In the battery, you have besides the fluid, which is an acid, also the positive and a negative plates. And when the battery is discharged, these plates both will cover with material called lead sulfate. What is actually happening in the bulk phase is that due to the charge voltage, there is a current flowing through the plates and through the fluid surrounding them. This current triggers the breakup of the fluid. The breakup of this fluid forces molecules to be released from it. These molecules start a reaction with the lead sulfate on the plates, which makes the plates return to the original structure of a fully charged battery. This original structure means that the positive plate will be covered with lead and a negative plate will be covered by lead oxide. When during the course of charging there is lead sulfate on these plates, less molecules are needed. But due to the high charge current, there is a surplus of molecules available. This means that these extra molecules cannot participate to react with the lead sulfate and escape the process by leaving the fluid. When this is happening, the guessing voltage is reached. This gas is, by the way, highly toxic and quite dangerous as it is explosive. This gassing should therefore be prevented at all times. So when reaching the guessing voltage, the charger switches over to its next phase, which is the absorption phase. This is the phase that the voltage is prevented to go higher to avoid further guessing, and therefore the current gets lower and lower and lower. The absorption phase will bring the state of charge from the battery from about 80 to 85% to 100%. Finally, when all the lead sulfate on the plate is fully transformed into lead and lead oxide, the charging process has been finished. The charger will then reduce the charge voltage even further and enters the float phase. This is the phase where the charger acts only as a supplier for the DC loads if needed, but will not try to charge the battery any further. So by then, the battery is considered to be 100% full, or at least it should be when the battery charger is set up right. This is exactly the time that the battery monitor should jump to 100%, no matter what, because the charging is done. What do we know about the battery at this stage so we can enter the criteria into the battery monitor? Well, firstly, you need to know the capacity of a full battery. This is mentioned on the side of the enclosure of the battery. The setting for the battery capacity in the battery monitor is called the CB setting. You should always use the C20, a 20-hour value. This is the capacity the battery is able to deliver at a 20-hour discharge speed. Next is the voltage. The charger is in the float phase when the battery is full. So, the setting which detects this float voltage must be set just below the float voltage, but higher than the idle voltage of a full battery. This value is called VC in the menu of the battery monitor, the charged voltage. Besides this, or actually due to this voltage, we can also see an amount of current still flowing through the battery, despite the fact that the battery is already full. This current is the tail current, IT called in the menu, and that's also needed to set up the battery monitor. So looking from the battery monitor point of view, it needs to go to 100% when the following conditions are true. Firstly, the charge voltage, when the voltage charged is higher than the set points. So the setting of the VC needs to be set about 0.2 volt lower than the float voltage, as there are always some losses and the voltage can be changed due to temperature compensation. On a 24 volt system, this is 0.4 volt lower, and on a 48 volt, it's even 0.8. So on a 12 volt battery with a float voltage of 13.6, the VC needs to be set at 13.4. The tail current must be set lower than a certain value. Normally under the float voltage, a current is flowing of around 3-4% of the capacity. So when you fill in 4%, it will be okay for most batteries. So that's then 8 amp on a 200 amp hour battery. You can easily see what the tail current is for your battery, by the way. Just have the battery charger enter float, wait for about 5-10 minutes or more, and read out the current which then flows into the battery. That's your tail current. The setting IT needs to be slightly higher than this value. Then there is the delay. What time is needed for these criteria to be true before the synchronization takes place? Normally, if these mentioned criteria are true for a period of, let's say, 5 minutes, you may assume that the battery is charged up 100%. So for the TC setting, you may enter 3-5 minutes. If it's set up with a setting like this, the monitor senses automatically if the battery is full, or at least when the charger goes to float. So at every completed charge cycle, you should see 100% state of charge on your monitor. With this 100% state of charge, the battery monitor will start its calculation using the amperes flowing in and out the battery, and the outcome will be as precise as possible. Then, onto some settings to make the readout smooth. If you would look at the graph of the state of charge during discharging and charging, it should be that there isn't a big jump in state of charge after synchronization has taken place. A jump of a few percent is okay, as that's the expected error, I would say, but the high percentage is not okay, as this makes that readout less accurate. Well, how should you optimize this? Well, first of all, there's the charge efficiency. During charging, not all amps are being stored as usable energy in the battery. Always there are losses. Mostly chemical losses, which cause that there will be heat generated during charging, but also the fact that during charging, the voltage is higher than during discharging. So the difference between this is the energy which is lost during the charge and discharge cycle. So the monitor should know which is the factor of efficiency during charging. Normally, a lead acid battery has an overall charge efficiency of around 80-85%. The actual efficiency of a lead acid battery stretches out from 99% when the state of charge is low to about 5-10% efficiency when the battery gets in close to full. So if the battery is used in the top end of its capacity only, so the discharge isn't going any further than, let's say, 80% state of charge, the efficiency is worse than when the battery is discharged deeper on average. In such a case, 75-80% should be entered for charge efficiency. Next is the Purkert factor. The capacity on the lead acid battery seems to be a fixed value, but it's not. The faster you discharge a battery, the less energy you can take from that battery. So if you filled in that your battery is 100 amp hour, the monitor is reducing this value when the discharge current is quite high. When the discharge is, for example, 50 amp on a 100 amp hour battery, you should easily have a 50% reduction on the given capacity. Due to this, sometimes the percentage of discharge and the readout in amp hour seem not to be logical at all. So, the effect of the high discharge current has changed the available capacity value. A small note on this, when discharging is slow, slower than 20 hours discharge, with only a few amps, there is much more capacity than the given value. So this effect that works both ways. The factor to scale the capacity up and down is called the Purkert factor. A normal lead acid battery have a Purkert factor of around 1.24. If you have both charge efficiency and the Purkert factor set up perfectly, there should be hardly any jump in state of charge when the synchronization has taken place. Then there is another setting called maximal discharge floor. Especially lead acid batteries have less lifespan when discharged deeply. There is an optimum between the investment and performance, and at the lead acid battery of 12 volt, that's about 50% of the total capacity of the battery. So that value should be entered in the discharge floor. The time to go value, so the value which tells you how long you can go on discharging the battery at a certain discharge rate before it's empty, is depending on this setting. So coming back to the comment I started this video with, why is the battery monitor giving 80% state of charge while the voltage is low? Well, the monitor does not look at voltage to determine what the state of charge is. It only looks at amps. It uses current, charge efficiency factor, and the Purkert factor to calculate the current state of charge. So when I see a state of charge of 50% on a 100 amp hour battery, but it used only 20 amp hour, it's very likely that the battery has been discharged with a pretty high discharge current, which causes the actual capacity to be far less than what is written on the closure of the battery. Another thing is, no matter how precise you fill in the battery criteria values, there will always be a certain deviation between the actual state of charge and the calculations done in the battery monitor. When using the battery monitor daily, you should make sure the battery is charged full at least every 2 weeks to have the monitor synchronized and therefore kept the readout reliable. If not, the readout becomes more and more unreliable over time. Well, do these settings work at all systems? Well, unfortunately not. Let's suppose the charger is not a grid power charger, but a solar charger. Then it could well be that the voltage on the battery will rise during the charging, and then well before the battery is full, there is suddenly a cloud. Due to this cloud, the current drops to zero quite fast, but the voltage drops quite slowly. So in that case, it could well be that the voltage is above the float voltage for a while, and at the same time, the current drops below the set tail current of a full battery. What happens then is that there is a synchronization to 100% state of charge. That's not good, as the battery monitor assumes the battery is full, but it's far from that. Solution to this is that the charge voltage setting is not based on the float voltage, but on the absorption voltage. This means also that the tail current is higher due to the fact the absorption voltage is always higher than the float voltage. In this situation, the charge voltage setting, VC, is the absorption voltage, minus 0.2 volt at 12 volt. And the tail current is higher than normally, so in this case is about 5 to 6%. With these settings, also when charging from renewable sources, such as PV, the synchronization should work well. On lithium, all is a little bit different. For one, a lithium battery doesn't need an absorption phase. When the battery reaches the voltage of, let's say, 14.2 on a 12 volt lithium battery, it can be considered as fully charged. It does have an hour or two extra balancing time for the cells, but capacity wise, not much is happening in that period. So here the setting for synchronization can be at the end of the bulk phase. Take for the voltage charge, the absorption voltage minus 0.2 volt and corresponding tail current of about 5%. If that's true for 5 minutes, the battery may be considered full. So the TC is 5 minutes. Things which are also different at lithium is the charge efficiency. Most of the time that's 100%. So as all energy which is charged into the battery can be used later at discharging. So at lithium, the charge efficiency can be set to 99%. Besides this, discharge speed has hardly any effect on the available capacity. So the Peuker factor for a lithium battery can be set to extremely low value. So go for 1.05 here. Finally, the discharge floor for lithium. Well, to avoid unbalance in the lithium battery too much, which is often the result of deep discharge, but also switching off by the BMS, I would advise you to have the discharge floor set to 10 to 15%. Hopefully this explanation on setting gives you enough insight on how to set up the BMV battery monitor, smart shunt, and other devices working with a shunt. As you might know, there's also another way of battery monitoring in some Victron equipment, such as a multi or a quattro. And how strange it may sound after giving you all that information earlier, here the state of charge is based on measuring current as well, but the synchronization is based purely on a certain voltage. Because during charging, as said before, the state of charge point when going from bulk to absorption is also a reasonable fixed point. It can be used as a reference point for the algorithm. So the battery monitor can look at this point to jump to a certain state of charge. At a lead acid battery, the state of charge when going from bulk to absorption is about 80 to 85%. So when this battery monitor is used, the state of charge is set at 80% every time the bulk phase is finished. This means there's no need to get the battery fully charged on a regular basis anymore. Ideally for off-grid systems which are being charged by a generator, as running time is minimized then. This regular charging to 100% state of charge is for a lead acid battery, however, still advised, of course. So in this case, having the generator run until the absorption phase has ended needs to be done every 2 weeks anyway. This is to keep the battery healthy. What's the negative side to this way of determining the state of charge? Well, with this way of monitoring, only current is measured from and to the multi or the quattro. So when there is a discharge from the battery directly, or charging done directly to the battery, the multi isn't aware of this, and there will be a huge deviation as far as the state of charge readout. This makes a readout basically useless. But when having charge and discharge only done by the charger inverter, this way algorithm for state of charge calculation works very well, especially because you don't need to wait until the battery is fully charged. This is good news for ESS systems and systems charged with generators, because charging until the absorption phase has ended is far from efficient, and actually you want to avoid this as much as possible. One comment on this is, when having a Victron MPPT and a multi connected to the same system with a Venus device, such as a servo, the charge current value from the MPPT is forwarded to the multi and is also taken into the calculation algorithm for the state of charge. With having a servo or other Venus device for system monitoring, automatically the best state of charge source will be chosen. So when only multi is connected, it will use this internal battery monitor as source for the state of charge. If you have a shunt installed, like a BMV battery monitor, this will be used instead of the multi algorithm. And when a so-called smart battery with a CAN bus, which forwards its own state of charge, is connected, this value is prioritized. A small note, it is best to set a Venus device to override the VE bus state of charge calculation with that one of the BMV or smart battery, as then the whole system works with one state of charge level, which makes programming on alarms and relays much easier. This was all for now. Hopefully you learned something from this explanation. If you have more questions, please have a look on the Victron Energy community page, where also many answers on synchronization and battery monitoring are being found.